Children, today is a part of our Vigyan Jyoti project. We have arranged an inspirational talk to be given by Dr. G. Madhavan Nair, a famous Indian space scientist, former chairman ISRO. He is with us. Children, it is a great day for all of us to have such a great personality in the midst of us. Kindly make use of this program. And after the talk, sir wants to interact with all of you. Whatever the doubts you want to get clarified and whatever the things you want to talk to, sir, kindly unmute your mic and directly you can pose your questions. If not, you can put in your chat box also. We will produce to sir for the clarifications. Okay, now till that time, you kindly don't, you keep your mic muted, please. Once you want to ask the questions, after the talk is over, kindly you unmute your mic. Okay, now I request Madam Shanti, Principal of North Sikkim, to just formally introduce our sir to our audience. Please, Madam.
Good afternoon, sir. Extremely happy and privileged to introduce you to this group of Vigyan Jyoti, comprising of students of Navodaya Vidyalayas and students from our neighboring schools who are part of this program. Sarna swagatham cheyyunnathil valare valare santoshamundu.
Yes, good morning.
So we'll start with a very brief introduction of sir. Shri Madhavan Nair, hailing from Kulashekaram, now in Kanyakumari district and erstwhile in Travancore state, is a very familiar name in the field of rocket technology. Conferred with Padma Bhushan in 1998 and Padma Vibhushan in 2009, his contributions are remembered and cherished for their emphasis on self-reliance in the high technology areas and the goal to bring the benefits of space technology to the community, to the common man, specially targeting the needs of the rural and poor sections of the society. Nair sir graduated from College of Engineering Trivandrum and underwent training in Bhabha Atomic Research Center, Trombay, Mumbai. Since his joining in Tumba Equatorial Rocket Launching Station in 1967, he has held enviable positions, and the most illustrious was that of Chairman ISRO, which he held for 6 years between 2003 to 2009. This tenure as Chairman ISRO and Secretary Department of Science saw 25 successful missions accomplished. Mr. Nair's success lies in the fact that he gave a major thrust for evolving application programs such as tele-education and telemedicine. Today, more than 31,000 classrooms are connected through EduSat network, and telemedicine is extended to 300 plus hospitals, including mobile units. Thanks to him, village resource centers are connected through satellites, and VRCs enable online interaction between the local farmers and the scientists. VRCs provide information on many governmental schemes, farming systems, action plans based on weather, community-specific advice on soil and water conservation. During his tenure as director of Liquid Propulsion System Center from 95 to 99, India's efforts towards indigenous development of cryogenic technology to concrete shape, vital infrastructures were built and critical technologies developed. As director VSSC, he led his team towards the development of India's geosynchronous satellite launch vehicle, GSLV, capable of 2000 kilo class of satellite into geo transfer orbit. The project was successful in the very first attempt. As Chairman Space Commission, his major thrust was on scientific exploration of outer space using the AstroSat and Chandrayaan moon missions. He has the credit of leading several international delegations on peaceful use of outer space. Sir's autobiography, Agni Parikshigal was published by DC Books in 2017. A very hearty welcome, sir, and it's a pleasure for us to have you here. Over to Ramachandra, sir. Thank you so much.
Good evening, sir. It's a privilege us to have your blessings again. I remember things is to 100 students for JV from Hyderabad region at Indian Science Bangalore kept going for promoting science. And sir, this through the Vigyan Jyoti, we have in the girl students, nearly 2,500 girl students are being mentored to join the scientific field as researchers. We have started this activity from the school level. This is a direct blessings from Department of Science and Technology, sir, and probably your blessings today will continue our passion. But for coming, sir, I request Mr. Khan to formally welcome you to the gathering, sir.
Sir, Kaurish sir is.
Yeah, please go ahead.
Sir, kindly, sir, you yourself can in the welcome, sir. Sir, then that's better. I think sir's audio is not available.
Kaurish sir is there.
Yeah. Kaurish sir is there. Okay, sir, please.
Oh, respected G. Madhavan Nair, sir, all present on the panels and all the girl students watching this program, my dear students. One of the most important purposes of this Vigyan Jyoti program was to inspire you, to give you some role models that can motivate you and can give you the compelling reasons for pursuing science as a career. Who else can be a better idol today? Those who have general ambition for science and those who have space science as a particular ambition. Nobody else except Madhavan Nair ji can give you that inspiration. Here is a person, Padma Vibhushan. He was the CNN IBM Man of the Year, Padma Bhushan, and has lot many contributions in the areas of science. Born on 31st October 1943, he is still pursuing his passion for making science reachable for the rural people, especially for the poor people. We have taken all the challenges of science, especially science, space science, in his guidance. We always hear this type of sentence when something is not that difficult, we say, you don't understand. That makes rocket science one of the most complicated sciences that we study. For Mr. Nair, rocket science is the letters of alphabet for us. And that's why you people can get tremendous, genuine, original guidance from such a luminary for that. My regards to you, sir. And I welcome all my deputy commissioners, assistant commissioners, principals, teachers, and students of the Jawahar Navodaya Vidyalaya system, along with the system, students of Kendriya Vidyalayas and other fraternities who will be watching and getting benefits from the priceless advice from the great men of this soil. Here is a person who took challenges for the whole country, not for himself. We were stopped to give cryogenic techniques and he got it done inside the country. Atmanirbhar Bharat, you here today, but he is the epitome of how our country can become self-reliant as far as space science is concerned. No wonder now we are carrying more than 100 satellites in one go. And almost every country, including developed countries, are getting their satellites launched by our ISRO, which was headed, initiated, nurtured, and nourished by none other than Mr. Madhavan Nair. Thank you, sir, for coming. I welcome you on behalf of Navodaya Vidyalaya Samiti and this Vigyan Jyoti program once again. Thank you, sir. Namaskar.
Sir, sir, you can start, sir. Thank you, sir. Please.
Thank you very much for the warm welcome and the nice words of introduction delivered by Srimati Shanti, office bearers of the JVV, headmasters and headmistresses of various schools, prosperous teachers, and my dear children. It is my proud privilege to be here joining you in this evening on a webinar mode and discussing some of the challenges associated with the aerospace technology in the country. I must thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity. I love children. So that's the reason I said that I will limit my talk to a very brief one, and then later we get into a discussion mode. Well, aerospace is a very vast area, and it's very difficult to cover all aspects of it within a very short time. It covers the aeronautics related to the aircrafts. Then we have the rockets and satellites related to space research. Then the missiles, which are required for the defense program, and so on. So this wide spectrum of areas is what is encompassing the aerospace technology encompasses all these wide areas of technology. Well, as far as India is concerned, we can be really proud that in several areas, we have made quite a big advances, and our technologies are in par with the global leaders in this field. But in some areas, we are lagging behind as well. Now, to look back in history, you know, in the Vedic time onwards, the people are referring to the flight of the human beings out of this planet Earth. Well, I think it's a well-known story about the Pushpaka Vimana being used by Ravana for abducting Sita Devi. And then also there is an ancient script called Vaimana Shastra, which again describes the basics of the flying objects, its shape, size, and some of the aerodynamic characteristics, some of the high-tech materials which are being used in those, conceived in those days. How far they are realistic, how far they are realized, we don't know. We don't have any remnants of that. There is no solid proof. But still, the idea of flying and making even rockets and missiles. And you see the references of one arrow being let off and then reaching multiple targets. The multiple re-entry missiles, what we are having today is really what you call a modern version of that. So the imagination of those people there, the concepts of those people there, very, very strong. But unfortunately, after the foreign invasion starting from 600 AD onwards, our civilization had a setback. All this creative thinking and the type of nurturing the science, technology, etc., has gone to the back burner. The foreigners, they wanted to make use of the India, or rather exploit India for the resources rather than develop the people here or develop the country. But it is independent in India. We have taken a very bold decision, especially under Jawaharlal Nehru's time. He has taken bold steps to strengthen our Institutes of Science, then establish the IITs and also several laboratories for space research, atomic energy, agricultural research, medical research, and so on. The result of that we are reaping today. We are happy that in many of these areas we are able to excel. Even when in the COVID times, when you are in need of a vaccine, there are at least about half a dozen laboratories in India who are capable of developing this and putting into trial. So that's a kind of technical excellence what we have achieved. Now, look at the field of rocketry. Well, I think, again, we have got a little bit of ancient history. The Tipu Sultan, he was living about 300 years back, I think. At the time, he has made a rocket and used it as a weapon against the British army in the Sriranga War. Certainly, that was a real terror to the British regime. And they were about to be, they were about to surrender. But unfortunately, due to some cheating and all those things, they overtook the Tipu Sultan, captured his entire regiment, especially the rocket and rocket technicians, and took them to UK. So that's the end of it. But later, they would have used this technology along with the V2 rocket technology, which they got from the Germans, to make a rocket system for the Western world. But here in India, we had a big lull period again. And after independence, we started making some small missiles like anti-tank weapons and so on. But it is in the 60s that India really woke up and took up the challenge of developing the rocket systems for the country. It is our great visionary leader, Dr. Vikram Sarabhai, who set the goal that India should be second to none as far as mastering the space technology is concerned, and we should be able to use this advanced technology for the benefit of the common man. We truly lived up to his expectation. As you are, all of you are aware, it was in 1957 that the first launch of an artificial satellite by Russian, the Sputnik, was placed in a orbit around Earth. Hardly 5 years from then, in 1963, Dr. Sarabhai conceived a rocket launching station at Tumba Equatorial Rocket Launching Station near Thiruvananthapuram. And I had the opportunity to be associated with that from 1967 onwards. So I am virtually, I lived the history of Indian rocketry and the space technology in the country. Now, while we were using some borrowed rockets for atmospheric studies, again, it was Dr. Sarabhai who set the goal that if Russia can launch an artificial satellite, why not India? Of course, the Russians, they had the backup of all the missile technology, the rockets made for the ICBM, IRBM. Similarly, US also had similar thing. And those are the rockets which are retuned to achieve these space missions. But in India, we had to start from scratch. And that was a big challenge. And of course, Dr. Sarabhai is a very shrewd man. And he has selected Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam for this challenging job for developing a rocket system which can take a 40 kilogram satellite into low Earth orbit. Nearly 10 years of tapasya by thousands of people has ultimately resulted in the successful launch of the Rohini satellite in 1980. Of course, the first attempt of the SLV-3 was a failure, but we learned a lot from the failure, and that's a one stepping stone towards the modern technology. From there, it evolved the PSLV, the Polar Satellite Launch Vehicle, a huge rocket system, which I had the opportunity to lead the team at the time. And today, that has become the workhorse launcher for the country. Nearly 50 launches have been done so far. And touch wood, we were lucky to have not more than 2 failures in this. So this is a sort of a world record. Normally, about 10% of such launches fail, end up in failure, even in developed countries. But India has shown to the world that we can provide a reliable launch system and perhaps cost-effective as well. That's the reason that many of the countries from outside are coming here to make use of the PSLV on a commercial basis for their launches. This PSLV is the one which you use for going to Moon as well as going to the Mars. Later, of course, the much higher lift capability vehicle, GSLV, was developed, and the cryogenic engine was a key element in that. And we have succeeded in totally indigenizing the cryogenic technology and releasing the GSLV Mark III. Today, perhaps the heaviest launcher system in the country, which can take about 10 tons of payload into orbit. So this 10-ton capacity is more than adequate for taking the human capsule, the Gaganyaan, to the space, and then its safe return. So that way, we have more or less realized self-reliance in the space research, and our spacecrafts are doing a lot of practical application in Earth observation, agriculture, forestry, fisheries management, water resource management, etc., and also the security needs looking across the border and so on. Similarly, in the communication field, it has revolutionized. Today, you know, with a small dish on your rooftop, you can receive hundreds of television channels at one go. Similarly, every nook and corner of India is provided with connectivity. In many areas, even the wideband digital connectivity is available through the satellites. And the practical applications like telemedicine, tele-education, village resource center, they speak volume. Today, you know, in this COVID time, we are all used to this tele-education technique. I'm talking about 2005, about 15 years back. We didn't have any of this LAN connectivity and the capacity to have the video conferencing. We tuned the satellite system for providing this, and the result was the EduSat, which provided connectivity to various schools, IITs, management institutes, and so on. And that is a pre-runner to what you are enjoying today, the technology what you initiated that day. Similarly, telemedicine. A person who is sitting in a remote village can access to the specialist in a town and then have a consultation without traveling thousands of kilometers. So this has been a boon to the country, especially for the poor people living at faraway places. The disaster management system, which is operational here, is very unique. We are using the capacity to observe the planet from the geostationary orbit. From there, you track the cloud formation, the cyclone formation, etc., its movement, and give a forecast in such a way, at least 2 days ahead of the impact, so that the people can be evacuated and a lot of saving in life and property can be made using this disaster warning system. The navigation area, GPS was one of the basic, what do you call the baseline for the entire global community. But we have launched 7 geostationary satellites by which the entire Indian continent, the surrounding region, will be provided with our own navigation, which are much more active and which are controlled by the government of India. So that way, I think we have a unique system of navigation also we have put in place. Planetary exploration, going to moon and confirming the presence of water there has been a great achievement. Subsequently, we have sent a probe to Mars. It has taken several pictures and some scientific data about the Mars and sent it back. And the next attempt for landing a rover on the moon, it didn't succeed fully. Only the orbiter is working very well. But the lander mission last went, something went wrong. We are trying to be the process of fixing it and going for the next launch soon. Now, that's on one side. Now, once we have the SLV-3 development completed, those rockets are capable of being converted as an IRBM. The government's policy is the Space Department is to engage only in the peaceful application of the technology. So naturally, the missiles are beyond our scope of work. So they have taken a wise decision to take Dr. Kalam to Defense Research Organization. And there, he has initiated what is called the Integrated Missile Development Program, starting from small rockets for the anti-tank, the surface-to-air missile, air-to-air missiles, and ship-to-ship missiles, and so on. But the main thrust came in the Agni series of missiles, used to start with over 1,000 kilogram range, and today Agni 5 is reaching up to 5,000 kilometers with the weapon system. In the weapon system development, yes, it was a very atomic energy department had a basic strength, and again under the leadership of Dr. Kalam, the first atomic device was exploded, and today we have got a sufficiently good stock of these weapons with us. So all these elements put together, the missiles and the atomic weapon put together, it is a tremendous strength for the ISRO, I mean, in the Indian community, and that is what acts as a deterrent. No neighbor will attempt anything on us after seeing our such capacity, and we hope that nobody will take an adventurous step towards attacking us. So this weapon system, what we have developed, goes for that. Coming to the aircraft area, which is not that bright, we have been using the aircraft made by foreign manufacturers for civil transport right from the mid-30s onwards. The Tata group at the time started the passenger travel within India. And later, of course, Air India and other things. And today there are many private players who provide. But all of them depend on the foreign-made aircraft system for its operation. For the military is concerned, again, we had a heavy dependence on the Russians, and the most of the military aircrafts came from Russia with a licensed production agreement in the Hindustan Aeronautics Limited. But again, under Dr. Kalam's leadership, they formed what is called the Aeronautic Development Authority of India, in which the light combat aircraft, a jet aircraft for the use for the combat and going to supersonic speed, has been developed, and that has been injected to the Army, Navy, and Air Force. So that is a major achievement in terms of the military aircraft is concerned. Next generation aircraft design is in progress, and so on. So basically, in the air, the passenger civilian aircraft field, we have not done much. There, the big challenge exists. Many of these countries, like especially the Europe and America, is controlling this field. Aircraft technology is not a simple one. It encompasses almost all branches of engineering, and also the various kinds of sophisticated materials, lightweight materials with high temperature withstanding capability and high strength are required for the purpose. Then sophisticated controls using the computers for navigation, guidance, and autopilot is required, the landing gear, and so on. So there's a host of technology elements need to be developed. Then it has to be integrated to the aircraft. And again, in all these aircraft, we should achieve zero failures. That means it should be totally reliable. We should provide redundancies to the extent possible, and so on. So that is where the major challenge lies. It is just not realizing an indigenous aircraft, but also we should be able to create an ecosystem in which all these high-tech items can be produced in the country. Many of the private players can play a very major role in this. Government also can play a very major role. Certainly that is something as a gap area where things have to start. Many of the technologies which is developed in the space and the missiles can be adopted for this purpose as well. So as far as space travel is concerned, the human flight is the next big objective. Then again, robotic exploration of the moon or Mars is going to be a big challenge. And there are private firms from outside. They are conceiving commercial space travel for the tourism or other purposes. So a lot of potential exists in these areas, and our country should not be lagging behind in such areas as well. Now, the uniqueness of all these activities in the country is that it is entirely homegrown. Because of the potential of civilian as well as military use, none of the foreign countries will share the know-how of these systems. And also everything had to be developed from scratch. the type of materials which are required for space application, the cryogenic application, the spacecrafts, the composite material which is required, the electronics and control systems, instrumentation, and so on. You name anything in this field, they are all developed in our laboratories here in India. And again, we did not have many foreign returned scientists or engineers joining this stream. It is all the fresh youth from the Indian colleges and Indian universities who have taken up this challenge. They learn while developing the system. They have failed several times, but from the failure, they were not put off. They have picked up on the success story. They built a success story out of failures. That's one reason that India is able to deliver reliable and cost-effective service in all these areas. So certainly this is a fine example for almost everybody to follow. And I'm sure the youth in the country will take on this challenge for the future. It is immaterial what area which you select, but you have to be thorough. Your fundamentals should be strong. You should have a good logical thinking, and you should be able to apply the knowledge what you are acquiring for solving the problems of society. Then success will be yours. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, sir. Now, some questions from the audience, sir. Okay, sir?
Yeah.
Please. Ramnan, sir? Hello. Mr. Ramnathan, sir? Madam. Stella, madam. Kindly, carry on with your question, please.
Distinguished resource person of this session, Dr. Madhavan sir, and other officers from NBS, and dear children, good evening to all. It has been a very interesting and enriching session, sir. I am really happy that I got an opportunity to attend this session. And you have shared a lot of information, how our space technology has grown and how it is blossoming and flourishing further. Sir, I have a question that is in relation to the gap between the skills that are required in the field and the skills that are provided by the education system. We have plenty of engineering colleges in India, and many engineers are churned out. Approximately 1.5 million engineers are coming out every year. But when we come to talk about the availability of the skilled workforce, we have to accept that there is a big gap. There is an enormous gap between the skills that are required and the skills that have been provided by the education system that are available with the candidates. So how we can bridge this gap, sir? Even in renowned government organizations like ISRO and DRDO, then say HAL, even these organizations, they got a lot of restrictions and they do not freely collaborate with the budding engineering talents and give them opportunities to explore their skills and to collaborate. There is a big gap in collaborating between the industries and the academia, sir. So how we can bridge this gap, sir?
Well, it's a very, very relevant question. Today, our education system has a lot of shortfalls, and perhaps that's one reason the national education policy has been put in place today. And that addresses several of these issues, but it will take a little bit of time before it comes to reality. But the basic deficiency which I have seen is at the education stage, whether it is school or college, the skilling is not given importance. In fact, as time passed, it became more like a memory test for the children. Whatever they learn, they don't have to apply in a practical field. So that skill is what is required in getting into an R&D organization and pursuing the technology development or the scientific development. So the logical thinking and the practical experiments has to be brought back. I know that in the schools, this Athal Tinkering Laboratory scheme has been announced by the government, and there are a few of the schools are equipped. But I wish that such school facilities are available to every school so that students have an opportunity to wet their hands at that stage itself. When it comes to the college level, especially ISRO, DRDO, etc., we promote the practical projects to be done by the students in their facility itself. If they come out with a proposal for developing either a new component or a new system, the funds are being provided, and the teachers will have to provide the guidance. The ISRO senior members also will participate in that. This program is very much there, but the takers for this is very minimal. They're all busy with the academic schedule. They have hardly time to think anything else. So the net result, such programs gets neglected. Not that we don't have a system. Visit to these facilities are concerned, in a controlled way, always it is possible, because we are dealing with a very high tech, and many areas are secret. So we cannot throw open all the laboratories for this purpose. But the organizations, when they are approached, they provide opportunities. Now, considering these deficiencies only, we have conceived what is called the Indian Institute of Space Science and Technology at Thiruvananthapuram. There, we have taken a philosophy to capture the students when they are young. So after plus two, the students are inducted into the space technology course. And after 5 years of course, they are absorbed into the space program. There, the teaching is essentially oriented towards the space-related subjects, and they are given opportunity to experiment themselves and also work with the ISRO establishment. So that is one example. So perhaps such issues can be replicated. So that will provide a team-specific training and orientation for the students. But my advice to students is, don't be satisfied with the normal curriculum, mugging things and reproducing it. It is more like a memory test. Go beyond that. You have enough time at your disposal. It's only 8 hours per day you spend at the college. Remaining time is available. Try to do some practical work, either in collaboration with few friends or with some of the laboratories or factories. So that way the practical skills can be developed. I've seen at the Pune Engineering College, again, they have created a big laboratory, workshop and all other things together. It is open all through the night. The students go there, they try to implement the project and then wet their hands. So similar setup again has to be replicated in other colleges as well. So that's one way of overcoming this deficiency. Yes, it's a fact that today's product which comes out of the engineering colleges or the universities, they are not employable. That situation should change. Under the new education policy, there is adequate scope for it. And it all has to start with a research culture in the higher education institutions and a sort of a scientific mentality, scientific temper to be created at the schooling stage, and developing some of the practical skills at the time itself.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Ramachandran from Kerala, he's raising his hands. Please, sir, Ramachandran, sir, kindly go ahead.
Okay. Good afternoon, sir. Can you hear me, sir?
Yeah, good afternoon.
Sir, I have a doubt. I'm proud of being an Indian, and I'm very proud of its great achievements made by ISRO, sir. At the same time, we are all the beneficiaries of the wonderful developments in the field of science and technology. Sir, ISRO made great progress, sir. But I have a simple question, sir. We spend a lot of money for the projects like Gaganyaan, Mangalyaan and all. How it will benefit the common people, sir? All other projects, common people are also benefited, sir. These projects, how will they affect the common people? What will be the benefit of the ordinary people, sir?
Well, one thing, if you look at the ISRO's budget, 95% of the budget is being used for projects which are of direct benefit to the people. Remaining 5% is being used for space exploration space exploration, mainly on the fundamental questions as to how and why of our existence, where the galaxies came from, where it is going, and what, as part of that, what is our future, and so on. So this knowledge very much is required for our existence, especially in terms of various calamities like climate change and other things which is happening, and so on. Now, this practical applications, I have briefly mentioned in my talk, it covers Earth observation, communication, and scientific exploration. Earth observation and communication is the mainstay. Using these, the practical projects given like disaster management or the telemedicine, tele-education, etc., they are not charged. But one of the economic schools in the country has made a study. Suppose you value those services, what is the impact? They came out with a very surprising research. For every 1 rupee spent on the Indian space program, 1.5 rupee is returned to the country. So that's the kind of benefit which is given to the country. In that process, we have to be abreast of the technology, and also we have to be in par with the other nations. Well, as far as satellite launch vehicles or satellites are concerned, our technology is as good or even excelling many of the global players. The only gap area what we had is a human spaceflight. As you know, the Russians and Americans, they were leaders in this field. And later, China also achieved self-reliance in this field. India is only lagging behind them. So we thought it is high time that we spend part of our budget towards this. If you distribute to the entire population of India, the population is making a contribution of roughly 1 rupee per person for this program. It is simply affordable, but it is very much required for keeping abreast with the space technology.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, sir. Sir, it is a question people are writing. Our Ramanand sir is waiting. Ramanand sir, kindly go ahead.
Yeah, please.
Mr. Ramanand sir, go ahead. Okay. Or if anybody, you can unmute your mic, kindly carry on, please. If his voice is not clear.
Good evening, sir. Myself, Nandan Hegde from JNB Bangalore Urban, sir.
Good evening.
Sir, you worked in ISRO when it was sprouting, sir. You may have faced a lot of hindrances, sir. How did you motivate yourself and your team while overcoming those hindrances, sir?
Basically, it is a technical challenge which has motivated all of us. We were doing something new. In fact, I have not learned anything about rocketry while in college. It is under Dr. Abdul Kalam that I picked up all the fundamentals regarding the rocket technology and also the leadership style which I have engaged from there. So this is the thing which every ISRO person is proud of. They learn while they are doing the job and they become super specialists in the concerned fields. So this is the uniqueness of our organization. There may not be many papers published by the ISRO scientists. Of course, two reasons. One is they spend most of the time in developing new technologies. And secondly, these technical details cannot be put in the public domain. But at the same, more than that, it is the work environment. You said how you withstand failures and how you really face the challenges. Let me give you this simple example. The first SLV-3 was a failure. Dr. Kalam was a leader and many of us were working with him on the project. Immediately after the failure, Professor Satish Dhawan, who was the chairman of ISRO, went to the public and said that we have failed. I take the entire responsibility for the failure. This was a statement made by him. What more motivation you need? There was no witch hunting. There is no point to finger anybody. He has simply owned the entire failure on himself. At the same time, he asked the right questions to all of us so we could find the answers within a very short time. And within 1 year, we went for the launch. and the launch was a tremendous success. At the success time, he pushed Dr. Kalam to the front, and he has given the entire credit to Dr. Kalam and his team members. So this is the first principle in ISRO where the leader owns up the failure, whereas the credit for the success is given to the team members. So this is something which you've learned out of that. And since then, that has been our motto and work culture in ISRO. Perhaps that's one reason that we are able to survive failures. We always convert the failure into a good lesson, try to analyze into the details how and why it went wrong, and ensure that corrective measures are put in place, such failures will not repeat in the future. That's one of the reasons that we are able to maintain a very high success rate for our launches as well.
Thank you, sir.
Sir, can you hear me, please, sir?
Yeah, please go ahead.
Sir, as you said that the new education policy is trying to disseminate this knowledge in the skill-based, sir. Okay. I want to know whether is there any private players which is used to disseminate this knowledge? Because we see in the computer science and all, many private players are coming. Because India is such a large country, to disseminate the skills, naturally the private players also plays a very important role. So is there any private players in India and which is recognized by the government to disseminate the knowledge and skills in this aerospace engineering?
Well, I think one of the policy decision is that even foreign universities will be allowed to set up their campus in India.
Sir.
Indian universities will be allowed to set up in foreign countries. So a healthy competition between the of course, India also, you know that 50% of the universities today are private operated. So this competition will lead to improvement in the quality as well. Now, using the skills for the national development, yes, I think one is, so far, the major thrust is the government agencies taking lead in advanced technologies. But to the education policy provides, or rather, the new development policy provides, every industry, whether it is private or public sector, and even the small-scale startup, to achieve towards self-reliance. Our products should be developed in such a way, they should be of international quality, we should be able to compete in the international domain and create wealth for our country. This opportunity is provided, and there is a lot of encouragement provided for the private startups. Whoever comes with an idea, the government supports with funds and guidance to make a success. There are incubation cells established, especially in IITs and many education institutions. So the youngsters can nurture their idea, and if it reaches a particular stage and requests for funding, either from the government or from the venture capitalists. So that way things are opening up. Maybe within the next few years, you see the transformation and its benefit for our country.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Yes, anybody, if at all you have any questions, kindly unmute your mic and pose your questions, please. Okay. So then, by the time, one small doubt for me also, sir. Sir, with our remote sensing satellites, is it possible to locate the presence of our nuclear fuels under our earth, sir? Especially uranium-235. Yes, sir.
There are techniques available, sir, by which the minerals can be identified, and sir, we have been using it. Especially, okay, we have spotted lot of uranium deposits in the northeast region, right, and of course, for various political reasons, we are not able to access them. I mean, the people won't allow the environmental protection groups and so on. But the satellite data has become useful for that. While you know, the one of the interesting application has been in the water resource management, using the satellite pictures in the desert region, etc., they were able to identify the location where you can have underground water spotted. So in country states like Rajasthan and Madhya Pradesh, this scheme has been implemented. More than a few lakhs of wells were dug in the region, and the success rate is something like 70 to 80%. So that shows how beneficial it is for our country.
Understood. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Please.
Sir, good afternoon, sir.
Yes.
Good afternoon. Yes. Sir, in our JNV, many girl children are going towards engineering and medicine and other field they are going. The number of children is entering in science, that is a scientist, they are very little less. So what suggestion you want to give to them, sir? Please give some suggestion to take science as one of the main subjects.
Well, all of us should recognize whatever life we are enjoying, the quality of life we have, the type of conveniences, the product, service, etc., is the result of the application of scientific achievements. So scientific achievement is something fundamental for our survival. We are living mostly on the findings from the Western world in these areas. And using that knowledge, those countries like Japan, Germany, other European countries, USA, etc., they have come out with very sophisticated products, whether it is for civil use or military use and so on. So the scientific discoveries and their application is the core, rather driving force for our civilization. So naturally, if India has to shine, several youngsters will have to come to that field. Now, you have pointed out that people take up engineering, medical, etc., etc. In some cases, it is more like a status symbol. In some cases, it is an urge for making a quick money. So these things are driving forces, but it cannot be. See, what needs to be done is, right from the young age itself, the parent-teacher combination has got a responsibility to identify the aptitude and taste of the student and groom them in the particular line. Some may be good in art, some may be good in science, some may be good in the sports and other practical activities and so on. So you groom in that line, the excellence will bloom. Today what happens, you try to put everybody into a common tight jacket and try to churn out, it is just like a product from a normal manufacturing factory. And the product I mentioned earlier, it is not usable. They are not employable. So that situation has to change. Again, the type of respect, the type of income and compensation, etc., in every field is attractive today. It's just not only in IT or in the medical profession alone. There are sportsperson who are making maybe 10 times more than a doctor or other engineer. And similarly, there are artists who shine so well. And above all, the need for social service. A country like ours, where 70% of our population live in the villages, they need to be provided with adequate knowledge on the healthcare, the food security, water security, and a good quality living. So all these needs various kinds of skills. So depending on aptitude, if you develop the children, they can go in. The first concept that only these high-tech area can, rather the currently so-called high-tech area only can provide the job opportunities and this thing is not correct. The simple fact that 90% of the engineering graduates who come out of the colleges, they are jobless because they concentrate on all the software and other things, which does not have much of application in day-to-day life. Whereas even for building highways, building electric system or the railways, etc., you require a lot of engineers and technical people. That's just not available. Then you take the medical profession. It has deteriorated to such an extent, a simple graduate from the medical college can do nothing. He cannot touch even a patient. he has to go through one or two specialized courses afterwards and spending a few crores of rupees before he gets a job. And that job also, except for a few government jobs or high reputed hospitals, all other places is peanuts. After spending this money, they get about 20,000 or 30,000 rupees per month, which is just nothing. In fact, the other day I was telling one of my friend that he missed the selection for a medical listing by a narrow margin. And then he wanted to go on the private allotment. And right today, the value is about 20 lakhs per year. So 5 years, 1 crore. So I told him, you start up a new company using that funds and you'll reach much greater heights in no time. So perhaps a value judgment is required, and this clamor for everybody to be a doctor or engineer that should vanish from our society.
Sir, next, what are the different avenues, sir, for our children to get into space programs?
Well, as I mentioned earlier, the people who are aspiring at the school stage, sir, they should learn well their fundamentals, the science subjects, basically chemistry, mathematics, physics, and biology. And then, of course, we are using the criteria of JEE for the selection process. Last year's record shows that people who got admitted into IIST is less than 5,000 rank. So that means, you have to have a good score. The second, even lateral entry is there after graduation. You should have a very good degree in any of the engineering branches or in the MSc in mathematics, physics, chemistry, or the space sciences. Then there is again a competitive test for the selection. And based on that also, people can get into it. And of course, ISRO is not a big employer in that sense. We are stabilized the manpower around 15,000. And that is a constant for the last 20 years. What we do is we palm out the work to the private industries and academic institutions. So their support is being drawn in. So many of the employment opportunities we are trying to create in the private sector itself. Then thirdly, research opportunities, there are many, and people should make use of it. And then I think the beauty of science has to be told to the students. You have to bring many eminent scientists in the country and organize such seminars. You can listen to them, their career, how they built up, and the challenges in the field, whether it is in the genomics or agriculture, whatever it is. So those things will open the eyes of the students. And there are opportunities. And in fact, the government is supporting with a lot of scholarship for people who want to pursue science and should make use of it. It's a sad fact that hardly 20% of such scholarships are being utilized by the students so far.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Children, any other questions? If not, then my deputy commissioner, Navodaya Leadership Institute of Hyderabad, is waiting, sir, just to formally place vote of thanks to you, sir. Sir, please. Yes, sir. Over to you. Okay, you have to unmute your mic. Sir, Gopalachan, sir, you would, please. Yes.
Sir, a very good evening to you. Respected Sri G. Madhavan Nayar Ji, NVS officers, principals, teachers, and my dear students. This has been one of the best motivational talks that we have arranged for the benefit of Vigyan Jyoti girl students, sir. It has, in fact, been a very comprehensive talk, a comprehensive inspirational talk, which had the element of inspiration, career counseling, career guidance, and also giving them tips to be successful in their life. Over and above that, we, being the teachers, we consider it as an inspirational talk for us, like how we have to create a suitable ambience for the children to take on their wings when they have to choose their careers. You have mentioned about the parents, teachers, and the schools, how together we have to give them a point of view, how we have to help them to choose their career. so that they will not become part of redundancy, which is a major problem that our country is facing. Out of 100 people, those who come out of the colleges, majority of them are becoming part of the redundancy, mainly due to we are not able to match them with the productivity of the work. Sir, in that way, the inputs that you have given us for the benefit of the Vigyan Jyoti girls students, I am very happy to place before you, sir, that in 58 JNVs, this program is in implementation, whereas your inspirational talk is going to be part of our archives and which is going to be open for the entire 654 schools across the country. And these girl students are being supported with a variety of programs, including this inspirational talks. And today's your inspirational talk on space exploration, the historical perspective that we have traced out from the days of epics is so inspiring to hearing from you, and which I am sure which is going to trigger the imagination and the creativity of the students. And the scientific achievements and inventions of India from time immemorial, listening from you will definitely boost the confidence of these Vigyan Jyoti girl students. And one of the most important areas that you have touched upon, which will definitely boost the confidence of these girl students, which were mostly the first generation literates, is the success stories that followed from series of failures. And we have repeatedly said this point, that a failure should become a stepping stone for success. And I think when we look at the history of Indian space exploration, there had been a number of failures. From each failure, the scientists have learned a great deal to go further. And you also have emphasized on how self-reliant and self-adequate the Indian technology has been. And this is all because of the concerted efforts of scientists like you. And I am sure, sir, this inspirational talk would go a long way in inspiring these budding scientists to realize their dreams and goals. Sir, on behalf of Navodaya Vidyalaya Samiti, our commissioner, and other officers who are present in this inspirational talk, the teachers and the students, I submit our gratitude to you for having spared your valuable time. It has been a great inspiring experience for all of us. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. My pleasure.
Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot, sir.
Thank you very much.
Okay, please, sir. Please.